Spain's Atlantic coast. Just beyond, Doñana. A shifting blend of river, sea, and sand. The sprawling delta of the Guadalquivir. Upriver, way inland, rugged mountains. Sierra Morena contrasts the coastal plain. Verdant in winter, in summer singed by a cruel sun. Delta and Sierra share one purpose, as sanctuaries of wildlife once abundant, now all but gone. These are the ultimate retreats of the world's rarest cat and its near exclusive prey. And it's the site of a modern miracle, Iberian lynx, once more born in the wild, in a human-dominated land. As old traditions combine with a new love of the wild, Iberia's iconic cat is poised to leap. Back. From the brink. The beaches of the estuary are alternately washed by the river and the ocean tides. Sahara dust blends with river sand from distant sierras. Each morning, new stories are found written across the dunes. The most thrilling ones are of a big cat. This remnant of wild Spanish coast is one of the last retreats of the world's rarest and most beautiful cat. Doñana's seasonal lagoons, shielded against Atlantic winds by a belt of coastal dunes, attract an amazing array of wildlife. This is Europe's Serengeti, a strictly guarded space where Iberian lynx can still roam, find prey, and raise their young. But to survive in the long run, lynxes need vast territories, much vaster than Doñana. An endless flow of guests and invaders from around the Med and from all the continents has made this paradise diverse. But since humans have taken over, wildlife has been on the retreat. Solitary pines and cork oaks echo primeval woods, giving Doñana that Serengeti look. But looking west along the coast, the wild abruptly ends. Huelva is an industrial port. In the opposite direction, Sanlúcar de Barrameda, a historic jewel. From here, the Spanish conquistadors set sail. The seaports, the Guadalquivir, and the Atlantic Ocean limit the lynx's realm on three sides. Inland to the north, Doñana borders Spain's most fertile plain, exploited soil from horizon to horizon. Doñana is where a few Iberian lynx have survived. But from a lynx's point of view, this wildlife ghetto offers little future. Lucky that humans have left at least one other patch of lynx land halfway intact. Andalusia's northernmost town seemed like a string of white pearls along the base of Sierra Morena. This 400 kilometers east-west range once formed the frontier between the Moorish kingdoms of Al-Andalus and the Christian kingdoms of central and northern Spain. For centuries, a no-man's land, often a battle zone, always a wildlife haven. These remote hills have been a secret stronghold of the Iberian Lynx, who once reigned the peninsula from the Pyrenees to the Atlantic and the Med. On first sight, much of today's Sierra Morena may look wild, even idyllic. But in fact, these are managed game parks for shooting. The Iberian lynx is much smaller than its northern cousin, too small to bring down prey the size of a red deer, except perhaps an occasional spring calf. For an azure-winged magpie, a mature deer is a safe outlook. When magpies appear, chances are that a lynx is on the prowl. For the past 6 months, the lynx has patrolled its territory in bright daylight. But when summer turns the Sierra into an oven, he'll just hunt in the cool of the night. Just like the local humans, the animals will avoid moving altogether. The Sierra is vulture country. In recent years, various vulture species have begun a promising comeback in Spain. On the Sierra's crags, hundreds of griffins are nesting again. In the shadow of the crags, Iberian lynx are doing what any cat will do. Next to nothing, all day long. The siesta may be Spain's best invention, but it's not a distinguishing feature of the Iberian lynx. The most obvious distinction is its size. One third smaller than the European lynx. Separated by the glacier-clad Pyrenees during the various ice ages, lynx populations north and south of that barrier adapted their body masses to different climates. Iberia has always been Europe's hothouse. And while northern lynx have to overwhelm roe deer, the peninsula offers much smaller prey. So this goat carcass isn't likely to be a lynx kill. Vultures are cautious. It may take days until a meal is seen as safe. But then all of a sudden, dozens of them drop out of the sky. And all restraint is dropped as well. Each of them knows, in no time at all, there will be nothing left. Among the griffin crowd, a black vulture. A sight even rarer than of the Iberian lynx. The vultures must finish long before sunset. They've gained weight and need the thermics to lift them into the crags. The sound of that motor is familiar to all the Sierra animals. Rangers of the European Union's Iberian Lynx Conservation Program are omnipresent in Sierra Morena. They are always patrolling, but today they cannot even afford a break. They have set up several cage traps, and in one of them, there's an animal. It's the animal they wanted. The team of biologists and vets is routined. They've done this many times, and yet each time, the adrenaline is high. But why capture an Iberian lynx when there are so few individuals left in the wild? Precisely that question has been subject to heated controversy among experts for years. Years during which the lynx population continued its nearly fatal nosedive. But meanwhile, there's a plan of action. Any captured lynx first goes through a health check. Probably no other wild animal species is being as closely monitored as the Iberian lynx. As an animal enters the programs for genetic exchange between isolated populations or breeding in captivity, vets make sure that it will not spread the disease and it is fit for breeding. The clinic where this happens is part of a lynx breeding station. There are four breeding stations, all of them in quarantine isolation, so they resemble high security prisons. Each one can hold 40 to 50 individuals. The Iberian lynx ex situ breeding program is the first of its kind. Other endangered cats across the world are likely to profit from its groundbreaking work. Tonya Rivers of the Athabucha station in Doñana explains.
The breeding program has two major objectives. First, in a highly critical situation in the wild, with the population on the brink of extinction, it was necessary to have a reserve population in captivity, in case some misfortune, say forest fires or an epidemic, would wipe out lynx in the wild. So here we had a biological resource bank from which a wild population could be rebuilt. The other major objective is to breed individuals that can be released to strengthen the wild population on the Iberian Peninsula.
Veterinarian Maria Jose Perez of the Olivia breeding station describes how she prepares young lynxes for their release.
Before individuals born in captivity can be released into the wild, we need to be sure that they master basic survival skills.
Food is used as a training incentive. The cubs need to be very good at every single step of the hunt, not just the kill. They have to be able to find a rabbit in their territory, to approach and catch it, to prevent its escape, and then kill it efficiently. Only if they can reliably do all that will they be able to feed themselves. This cub is 6 months old. In 3 months, it should be able to fend for itself in the wild. It still has a lot to learn. Catching a domestic rabbit is for beginners. Wild ones are a different matter.
Otro factor, otro comportamiento muy importante que tienen que tener preparado es la exploración.
Another key behavior is exploration, being prepared for surprises, being curious about the environment where they have to survive.
Curiosidad y de explorar todo lo que el entorno que tienen alrededor les puede facilitar.
They must not get used to having everything done for them.
No estar acostumbrados a tener todo.
Whatever they need, they must find by themselves. What's also important are relationships with other lynxes they will meet in the wild, individuals of the opposite sex, territorial adult males, and so on. They need to learn how other animals react and how to behave towards and communicate with them.
Once on their own, young lynxes will also encounter enemies. One species is particularly dangerous.
Entonces, el fomentar esas conductas huidizas que no se fíen de nosotros y eso.
They shouldn't trust humans. That's what makes our work in the breeding center a little more difficult. When they see us, we frighten them, so they learn to hide from humans.
Tengan una reacción de esconderse y de estar alerta. Y no de acudir y fiarse de primeras de las personas.
Human trainers and lynx mothers follow the same principles. One cub of this litter has already killed a rabbit, following its mother's example. The other two are still too playful. The mother confronts them with the prey and will not intervene, forcing them to feed themselves. But even with terrific training, releasing a cub into the wild is an emotional ordeal. The real world is so different from the enclosure. Full of animals the cubs have never seen, such as the omnipresent red-legged partridge, a tasty prey, but ever so evasive. A young lynx can't be released just anywhere. Even in an ideal habitat, survival is hard enough. The land must be open with hiding places, rocks, ditches, hollow trees and bushes. There must be water sources all year round. Most importantly, the newcomer must find prey. So, after roaming and exploring, where does a young lynx go? Where the rabbits are. Wild rabbits never venture far from their burrows. They stay alert all the time. Rabbits used to be abundant all over the Iberian Peninsula. In antiquity, Iberia was called Hispania, which means rabbit land. But that's history. Today it takes enormous efforts to make sure that enough rabbits are available to sustain even a small population of Iberian lynx. This biologist has been nicknamed the Rabbit Man, but he's more than that. Jose Maria Gil Sanchez is the mastermind behind a complex action plan to promote the Iberian lynx's comeback into the wild. Dead rabbits in the field in early summer are among his biggest worries. At a density as low as 3 to 4 rabbits per hectare, each loss poses a threat to the lynx. Rabbits were always abundant on the Iberian Peninsula, but in the mid-20th century, a viral disease introduced from South America cut down their numbers. Things got worse in the 90s. Another viral epidemic ravaged the rabbit population even further. Today, we see just a sad remnant of the rabbit numbers prevalent half a century ago. Viral hemorrhagic disease is one of the major impediments to the recovery of Iberia's rabbit populations.
It is therefore imperative that we monitor the land very closely to protect our efforts of rebuilding the lynx population, since the survival of the Iberian lynx depends completely on the rabbit.
The alarming fact is that in rabbit land, there are not enough rabbits today to support even a small population of predators. It's not just the Iberian lynx that's in trouble. It's the Iberian biosphere.
The Iberian lynx is a very vulnerable species because it is one of those rare cases in nature which depend on a single food source, just one prey species, the European rabbit. Wherever there are no or very few rabbits, the lynx cannot survive. This is why, as an important part of our efforts to strengthen the ultimate two lynx populations in Sierra Morena and Doñana, we are constructing such artificial rabbit burrows. These burrows offer the rabbits shelter. Around them, we are sowing forage plants. In areas with few or no rabbits, we can thus secure the survival and reproduction of rabbits and rebuild local populations.
In many areas where lynx have survived, or will hopefully be released in the future, hundreds of similar artificial rabbit dens have been built, using materials available in these areas. They've been stocked and restocked with tens of thousands of wild rabbits. This would be easier if domestic rabbits could be bred and released. However, they would not survive in the wild. All these rabbits have to be trapped on a few ranches where the abundance of wild rabbits is sufficient. Not all rabbits are as lucky as these new homeowners, who should soon breed like, well, rabbits. Some end up in small special enclosures in lynx land. This is Crystal. She needs rabbits right now. Crystal has three cubs to feed. For them, one rabbit a day is nothing. But in their territory, in Sierra Morena, there is simply not enough prey. The cubs pass the time playing while their mother enters the enclosure. This season, rangers supply rabbits on a daily basis, sometimes even in a cage. A lynx restaurant, and Crystal is a regular. Normally, the rabbits are running loose in the supplementary feeding enclosure, but in regular intervals, rangers combine a rabbit cage with a camera trap. Without supplementary feeding, Crystal's cubs would not make it. That applies to many of Spain's lynx litters. The Iberian lynx still depends on a complex support system, like a patient in intensive care. Just as lynx depend on rabbits, rabbits depend on natural vegetation. In this case, the stunning Mediterranean macchia. This is why Jose Maria is not just the rabbit man. He might as well be dubbed the macchia man.
The Iberian lynx depends completely on a special type of landscape which is unique on this planet and which has become extremely rare because it has been pushed aside by agriculture. The Mediterranean macchia is characterized by a group of plants adapted to an extreme climate, especially to long, hot and dry summers. Where we are right now, there was a dense pine forest a few years ago. The sun could not reach the floor through the canopy, and nothing would grow here. After removing lots of pines, we can now see the original macchia vegetation returning. For rabbits, this is a very favorable situation, and that's why it's good for the lynx. The rabbit population here is quickly recovering, so now it's a great lynx territory.
The Iberian lynx could do without human help if more natural macchia were left. But the onslaught on natural habitats on the Iberian Peninsula has been relentless for centuries, and never more aggressive than in recent decades. Even landscapes that may look natural are in fact anything but.
Historically, Spain has long suffered from a lack of timber. So during the 20th century, thousands of hectares were planted with fast-growing Mediterranean pine, creating forests like this one below. This happened at the cost of the Mediterranean macchia, the natural habitat of the Iberian lynx. Modern forestry is radically changing that, aiming at diversity and helping the recovery of the Mediterranean's natural vegetation.
This is the province of Jaén, just below Sierra Morena. One can drive for hours and see literally nothing but olive trees. Millions of them. Underneath the olives, it's a desert. Huelva province, right next to Doñana. Strawberry fields forever, or raspberries, it makes no difference. Not that long ago, much of this land was macchia, lynx land, rabbit land, and the transformation, although often illegal, continues. On the one side of Doñana, at least, the Guadalquivir draws a clear line between the more natural remnant of the delta and the not-so-natural east bank. The vegetation here, pear cactus from Central America, palm trees from Africa, eucalyptus from Australia, is a living record of Spain's history. The Guadalquivir links Seville with the Atlantic. For centuries, big ships from all the continents were a familiar sight to the Delta's wildlife. The new plants they brought, potatoes, tomatoes, maize, cotton, have replaced the Mediterranean macchia that once blossomed here. Meanwhile, this could well be Mississippi or Alabama. former realm of the Iberian Lynx is now ruled by King Cotton. Back in the quiet isolation of the Sierra, the big day is approaching for a little lynx. At the Olivia Breeding Center, the biologists have decided that two of this year's cubs have met all the criteria for release into the wild. It's graduation day. In the background, the entire team is waiting nervously to act the minute the cub enters the trap. In the eighth year of the breeding program, roughly a dozen lynx can be released into the wild each year, often in the presence of celebrities, politicians, and the media. This time, it's just the immediate family, with hearts throbbing. Everyone is thinking the same. Goodbye, little lynx. And good luck. To know whether an animal really succeeds in the wild, and to be able to intervene in an emergency, rangers follow the young lynxes day after day. This literally keeps rangers on their toes, but it produces valuable data and protects the huge investment made in each individual. A month after its release, this cub appears to be doing well. Not all the cubs have been so lucky. Creating a fantastic database about all of Andalusia's lynx, 350 camera traps were constantly in operation for years. Meanwhile, budget cuts have brought intensive monitoring to a grinding halt. To get a lynx in front of a camera trap, a rabbit or a pigeon is placed near a location known to be frequented. Twice a day, rangers visit each cage to make sure the rabbit is in good condition. After a day or two, it may be exchanged. It could be a long wait. Lynxes patrol vast areas, 10 square kilometers and more. to check the borders of their territories or explore new ones. Lynx kill quickly. For the rabbit, death is a sudden surprise. And there are plenty of surprises for scientists as well. For a young lynx, finding a territory in this man-made landscape is not easy.
As we are creating new populations in other parts of the country, we need to connect them so that animals born in Doñana can migrate to and reproduce, say in Sierra Norte or Extremadura, and an exchange can take place between Sierra Morena and Doñana. We need corridors of good habitat quality, green corridors, so that the various population centers can be connected. And this is mainly a matter of lynx mobility versus human mobility, especially around protected areas.
For a change, this is not another new road under construction. Gemma Ruiz is an expert in animal mobility. She knows what habitat fragmentation means. In spite of protests, roads were built right through Doñana. Road kills were the result.
This zone was frequently used by lynxes just when the general situation of the lynx population was most critical. There were many road kills, so we are taking various countermeasures. This bridge represents one of them. Plus, there are several underpasses down this road, all this in combination with fences. In this way, we make sure that there is a good flow of animals between populations on either side of the road. Seville is up here, the beach down there, with a continuous flow of vehicles in between, up to 20,000 per day. Now we need to enable a continuous flow of lynx crossing at these points.
Road traffic as a lynx hazard is not limited to Doñana. This is a modern-day pilgrimage. 1 million people on their way to the Holy Virgin of La Caviza, right at the center of Sierra Morena. A similar event in Doñana is even three times bigger. Spain's two oldest and biggest pilgrimages happen to take place in the country's last two lynx habitats. When the crowds are gone, silence settles again on the Sierra. But Sierra Morena has not always been a silent place. The hillsides are dotted with dozens of abandoned mines. Copper, iron, uranium. Some of the best lynx territories today are in fact around abandoned slag heaps and old mining structures. Apart from the state's nature reserves, what allows Iberia's big cat to thrive here now are traditional ways of land use on the Sierra's big private estates. Many landowners have committed to maintain landscapes favorable to wildlife. One such landscape is the pasture of the Spanish bull. This was a dance, not a fight. On this particular bull ranch, animals are not hurt or sold to the arena. Not that this would make much difference to resident lynx. The young cows and bulls need to be moved regularly. Every June, the yearlings are tested in the estate's small arena to select the fittest for breeding. Wild corners of these vast estates are ideal wildlife habitats. Even better for the lynx, cork oaks. Cork can only be harvested once in 9 years. There is little disturbance for wildlife, and with such traditional land uses, humans and lynxes can coexist in harmony. Some of these private estates are becoming invaluable havens for other endangered species as well, such as the Spanish imperial eagle or the black vulture. In fact, a wide range of wildlife is profiting from the efforts that have been invested in the lynx. And it is the lynx, that nearly lost Iberian icon, which is making people aware of Spain's and Portugal's natural heritage. However, here and there, some of the old lack of understanding still persists. In one of the new lynx territories, a female has been poisoned. Because this is a painful setback, and by no means unique, Authorities in Andalusia are using specially trained dogs to clear lynx habitats of poison baits and illegal traps. The dog can not only find poison, but also traps, such as snares. Much of what is illegal in Andalusia is still perfectly legal in other parts of Spain. The search dog and his guide work closely together because the dog is running a high risk when encountering poison or a trap. A fresh piece of sausage placed like that is probably deadly. This is close to where the poisoned lynx was found. Members of the environmental police unit secure the evidence of illegal trapping or shooting. Theft of bird eggs. Illegal and harmful deposits or soil, air and water pollution. Although many well-documented cases end up in court, convictions are scarce, and on big private estates, securing evidence is hopeless. Over the centuries, this savanna-like pasture has become characteristic of southern Iberia. On the so-called dehesa, domestic animals roam freely over vast areas, mingling with wildlife. Hundreds of thousands of Iberian pigs, scouring the dehesa for acorns, roots and herbs, produce pata negra, probably the world's finest pork. Much of Doñana is ancient dehesa, run wild. Wildlife rules. Even the horses that have shared the land with the lynx for at least half a millennium are undisturbed, except for the annual roundup. Some 1,300 horses roam the marismas all year round. These are the direct ancestors of today's American Mustang. The mares with new foals are separated from the rest and divided up between the various landowners. Then they are driven to the market of Almonte to be branded and sold. They ride through El Rocío, the famous pilgrimage shrine, on the edge of Doñana. All the horses must pass by the church. During the Rocío pilgrimage, a month earlier, 3 million worshippers congregate here. These hardy Malis Menus are Iberia's oldest breed, quite different from the Andalusians bred nearby. Doñana's lynxes don't seem to mind the traditional traffic through their territory. Big ocean ships, millions of pilgrims, and Europe's biggest annual roundup. By sunset, the dried-up lagoon at El Rocío is again the most tranquil place on the peninsula. And that's really all Iberia's icon needs. Tranquil places. Big, natural spaces. Many of them. Safe and well-connected. Beyond Sierra Morena and Doñana. Needs healing. Ongoing efforts to bring back the lynx may well be its best medicine.